one of the largest campuses in Japan, located in Tsukuba Science City. The University of Tsukuba has attracted students from more than 110 countries and regions with many degree programs. Close historical ties with the Olympic and Paralympic Games. World-changing, cutting-edge research. Diverse sports activities and clubs in the campus. Tsukuba Science City is the largest leading-edge R&D center in Japan.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Welcome to the 11th Simeo University of Tsukuba Symposium under the theme Technology and Values-Driven Transformation in Education. My name is Wichia Songyai. It's my great honor to be your MC at the symposium, which will be conducted for 3 days from today until the 22nd of February. Without further ado, let us begin with the first session, which is the opening ceremony. I am pleased to invite our moderator, Professor Nomura Nagao, Regional Director for Southeast Asia, Bureau of Global Initiative from University of Tsukuba. Professor Nomura, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Very good afternoon from Japan. My name is Nomura from University of Tsukuba. I'm honored to moderate this opening ceremony. First of all, I'd like to welcome Professor Dr. Benton Caroline Fern. She's the Vice President of University of Tsukuba. Kindly, we'd like to welcome Professor Benton. Virtual floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Caroline Benton, Vice President for Global Affairs of the University of Tsukuba. It is my great honor to give this welcome remark for the 11th Simeo University of Tsukuba Symposium, which is also one of the events celebrating our 151st and 50th anniversary of our university. First, I would like to give my great appreciation and thanks to Dr. Ethel Agnes Pascuela Venezuela, Director Simeo Secretariat, and also Mr. Kitayama Koji, Deputy Assistant Minister, Director of International Affairs Division, Minister Secretariat, International Affairs Division, the Ministry of Education, Culture, Sport, Science, and Technology, Japan. Dr. Ethel Agnes Pascuela Venezuela has formalized the University of Tsukuba Simeo Symposium and publishes the Journal of Education for Southeast Asia. Dr. Ethel has been the Simeo Director since 2019. Please accept our gratitude and appreciation for all the work you have done during your 4 years leading CMEO, as well as supporting the collaboration with our university. We will be very sorry to miss your leadership when you leave your position this March. Dr. Ethel is the first female director of CMEO since its inception in 1969. Her expertise is in the internationalization of higher education and transnational education, teacher education, alternative learning, and secondary education. Before becoming director, she served in the Educational Research and Innovation Office of CMEO Innotech from 2006 to June 2015, after which she became the first female deputy director for program and development of CMEO Secretariat from July 2015 to March 2019. I am truly grateful to have the opportunity to support this symposium, which is being made possible through the efforts of all CMEO directors, staff, and contributors. The theme of this symposium is Technology and Values-Driven Transformation in Education, which is a very timely topic in today's world. Beyond various challenges caused by COVID-19, we must work together to create a new normal in education in line with the changing values of society. Recognizing both the usefulness and limitations of technology and online education for developing the minds and characters of our young people, this symposium is the opportunity to review ongoing education as well as international movements such as OECD's Education 2030 and Forming the Future Vision for Education in a Digital Society. Education has been part of our legacy since our university's inception. The University of Tsukuba was founded in 1872 as the first national institution of higher education in Japan, in modern Japan. For 151 years, we have led the development of education systems, methods, and contents in Japan. And for 50 years, as the University of Tsukuba, we have begun to reform higher education. As an affiliate member of CMEO, the University of Tsukuba has been working with CMEO on this symposium for 14 years. We are also working with CMEO on its 7 priority areas, particularly in regards to revitalizing teacher education, harmonizing higher education and research, and adopting a 21st century curriculum. For example, the University of Tsukuba researchers, including Dr. Isoda, contributed to the establishment of science and mathematics curriculum standards for Southeast Asia. Furthermore, CMEO and the University of Tsukuba have been engaged in education reform to cultivate student agency that contributes to social change and global, regional, and local welfare. I hope that the 11th CMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium will be invaluable in the development of new educational methods and teacher training. On day 3, in session 5, Professor Ryosuke Oniwa from the University of Tsukuba will present the Japan Virtual Campus, which is an online platform that our university is promoting internationally with the Japanese government. Finally, I would like to express my appreciation to all speakers and participants for your valuable insights and your time. Thank you very much, and I hope everyone has a great symposium. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Benton, for your warm welcome remarks. Thank you very much. Next, I'd like to welcome the remarks from the CMEO site. This is Dr. Ethel Agnes Pascua Valenzuela, Director of CMEO Secretariat. Dr. Ethel, floor is yours.
Excellencies, Honorable Professor Dr. Benton Caroline Fern, Vice President of the University of Tsukuba, Honorable Representatives from the Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science, and Technology, or MECS, Japan, Professor Misami Isoda, Director of PSET, University of Tsukuba, Honorable CMEO Center Directors, distinguished speakers, friends, guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, Ohayo gozaimasu. On behalf of the Southeast Asian Ministers of Education Organization, or CMEO, it is my honor to welcome you all to the 11th CMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium. I would like to extend our heartfelt congratulations to the University of Tsukuba for its 50 years of success in fulfilling its mission as one of the outstanding universities in Japan. 13 years working with University of Tsukuba is indeed a milestone. We have established strong and deep
Cooperation and Collaboration as CIMEO affiliate member. And this year marks our 11th CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium. Since its inception as a CIMEO affiliate member in 2009, the University of Tsukuba, Japan has been one of the most active affiliate members, which has developed different programs for teacher capacity building and training, particularly in science, mathematics, and teacher education professional development. They have also participated in student exchange program under CTeacher. Over the last 10 years, the CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium has been organized annually with the different themes according to the needs and emerging issues in teacher education between Japan and Southeast Asian countries. The last 10th CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium with the theme Teacher Education in the Past, the Current, and Challenges for the Future was successfully conducted in February 2022. Over 19,000 educators participated in this CIMEO University of Tsukuba collaboration. This year, the 11th CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium has a theme Technology and Values-Driven Transformation in Education. We aim to provide a platform to showcase the best practices from all educational levels, as we also consolidate policy recommendations and as we identify opportunities and challenges in this educational transformation after the pandemic. Ladies and gentlemen, this 11th CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium is scheduled 3 days from today, Wednesday, 22nd February, and consists of 6 panel presentation sessions, all together with 31 distinguished and honorable speakers. I would like to take this opportunity to express my sincere appreciation to all the speakers from the University of Tsukuba, Ministries of Education of Southeast Asian countries, CIMEO Global Partners, University Partners, CIMEO Regional Centers, and schools under the CIMEO Schools Network. We truly appreciate your contribution and support to this symposium. Furthermore, again, I would like to thank the Center for Research on International Cooperation in Education Development, or CRISED, of the University of Tsukuba for being a very good partner of CIMEO for a long time. Our joint partnership activities have been strong and very productive as years gone by. I hope that everyone will join the symposium via our CIMEO YouTube channel and would stay up to 3 days and take benefits from this pioneering symposium. Thank you very much. Arigato gozaimasu.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ethel, for your warm welcome remarks. Okay, then next, I'd like to invite the representative from Minister of Education from Japanese government, Mr. Kitayama Koji, Deputy Assistant Minister. She's the Director, International Affairs Division, Minister's Secretariat. International Affairs Division, the Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science, and Technology, in short, MEX, Japan. Mr. Kitayama, virtual floor is yours.
Honorable Professor Dr. Caroline Benton, Vice President of the University of Tsukuba, Dr. Ethel Agnes Pascua Valenzuela, Director of the CIMEO Secretariat, Professor Masami Soda, Director of CRISED, CIMEO Center Directors, distinguished speakers and guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is a very great honor for me to have this opportunity to say a few words on behalf of the MEX, Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science, and Technology. First of all, let me express my heartfelt congratulations on the 11th CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium being held with many participants today and the next 2 days. I would also like to express my deep respect for the efforts of the people concerned, especially those in the Center for Research on International Cooperation in Educational Development, or CRISED, to continue this collaborative program every year with a timely theme. I understand that CIMEO, co-organizer of today's symposium, has been promoting regional cooperation in education, science, and culture over the many years since its establishment in 1965, and that it has been playing a vital role as a regional organization in achieving SDG 4. My ministry, MEXT, also started two programs with CIMEO around the same time the University of Tsukuba started the symposium. One of them is the dispatch of Japanese experts to CIMEO centers, and MEXT dispatched 60 experts from fiscal year 2011 through fiscal year 2021 in 10 years, in most cases in cooperation with Japanese universities. The other program is the implementation of the CIMEO Japan ESD Award, which recognizes outstanding ESD activities in schools in the Southeast Asian region. Like the Tsukuba Symposium, this award sets a timely theme every year, and the theme for the last year's award was education transformation through partnership. Education transformation was also the theme of the United Nations Transforming Education Summit in September last year. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the CIMEO Secretariat for its dedicated collaboration over the past 10 years. This year's symposium has a big theme, technology and value-driven transformation in education. During the pandemic, we have continued our desperate efforts to look for available technologies to maintain the quality of education in the environment where face-to-face teaching is restricted. As a result, we were able to find new possibilities for our education method, but at the same time, we are recognizing that some elements of the students' competency are not developed without face-to-face communication. I believe that sharing the experiences of education practice and the studies that summarize those experiences among the participants at this symposium will contribute to developing and disseminating educational practices that honor the fundamental values of education while making better use of technology. I'm also sure that this symposium will be a big seed for strengthening collaborative activities between Japanese and Southeast Asian schools, which have now obtained more options for their teaching methods. Finally, I sincerely hope that this symposium will be fruitful for all participants. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Director Mr. Kitayama, for your remarks. Okay, again, I'd like to extend my great appreciation for the three distinguished speakers for the opening ceremonies. And also, I'd like to extend my appreciation to the viewers. I heard more than 1,500 people are viewing now, and I really hope that all the people will gain a lot of knowledge and learn good practices and a fruitful discussion with the participants. Thank you very much. I'd like to close the opening ceremony, and I will return the virtual floor to the MCs. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Nomura Nakao, for moderating the opening session. Ladies and gentlemen, the 11th CIMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium will be conducted for 3 days. So for the first day, we will start with policy discussion, which focuses on technology and values-driven transformation in education. And we will end the first day with section two, which is technology and values-driven transformation in lifelong learning and holistic education. For the second day, we will start the second day with the recap of the first day of the symposium. And we have two sessions. The first one is technology and values-driven transformation in K-12 education. And we will end the second day with session four, which is technology and values-driven transformation in STEM and innovative vocational education. For the last day of the symposium, we also have two sessions. So we start the day with the recap of the second day of the symposium. And we have two sessions. The first one is technology and values-driven transformation in teacher and higher education. And we will end the last day of the symposium with session 6, which is innovative practices in technology and values-driven transformation in education, learning from action. But before we begin, I'd like to inform you that we have provided the Q&A form in case you would like to pose any questions or reflections you may have to our speaker. So you can scan the QR code which is shown on the screen or click on a link which appears at the chat box and in the description box on the YouTube. And please do not forget to select the session that you would like to ask and type in English. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, we will now start with the first session, which is a policy discussion on technology and values-driven transformation in education. Our moderator for this session is Dr. Kamaswaran Dayaraja, Research Evaluation and Assessment Specialist from Simeo Secretariat, Thailand. So Dr. Kamal, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. To our education officials, policymakers, teachers, researchers, and our participants for today's webinar, a wonderful afternoon from Bangkok, Thailand. We are beyond excited to learn from the insightful discussions from our speakers this afternoon. I'm Dr. Kamal, as already been mentioned by the MC. I'm the Research Evaluation and Assessment Specialist of Simeo Secretariat, and I will be your moderator for this session. To commence the first session on policy discussion, technology, and values-driven transformation in education, may I introduce the first speaker for the session? The first speaker will be delivering his key messages on navigating change, the role of technology, and values-driven transformation in Thai educational policy. He is currently the president of the Institute for Promotion of Teaching Science and Technology. He has received numerous number of substantial recognitions and awards throughout this career. He is none other than Associate Professor Thira Dajis Suksakun. Let us welcome Professor Thirade to the virtual stage. Professor, the floor is yours.
Okay, sawasdee krab. Good afternoon, all the executive members from Simeo and University of Tsukuba, honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen. It is such a great honor for me to give a presentation on behalf of the Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Education, Thailand, Dr. Atpon Sankawasi. And this is my first time here too. I have just been the president of IPST for just almost 6 months. So I'm very excited to be here. So today I will just give you a quick presentation on the navigating change, the role of technology and values driven transformation in Thai educational policy, especially in science, mathematics and technology. So first of all, I'd like to give you a big picture of Thailand educational issues that we have been experiencing for the past 3 years. The first issue is inequality. We have found that more than 1.4 million students with low socioeconomic status are more likely to lack access to the internet and smart device in their households. So that's why we have a big campaign on provide for like fundraising to give the student the smart device. And then secondly, we have been experienced the learning loss during the last 3 years, as I think all of us experienced the same thing. Many of them has been left out, not able to get any education, or maybe they don't have a chance to, you know, get any access to adequate education. So that's why the Ministry of Education in Thailand, led by the minister and also the deputy minister of education in Thailand, initiate 5 O's. The first O is on site, as we have been using it for like a long time and we're still using it. So we believe that teachers and students need to come together face to face so they learn from each other. And then we also have on-hand education to make sure that students are able to do, like especially in science, math, and technology, they have to do laboratories, they have to do experiments. So they make sure that they learn and understand what science and technology can do for them. And then we have like on demand. So basically we have the, a lot of things that maybe they want, they don't want. So we try to do like a tailor-made to make sure that they want to learn what they really want to interested in. And then we have on-air. On-air is the education that we have via like television and radio, which we have been doing it for quite some time because we have a lot of people in like all over the country. Like some area don't have enough teachers. So we need to give them, you know, the education that they can get like during on air as well. And lastly, we have online, which is a new thing. If we think about this, like 3 or 5 years ago, we don't even know a lot. I mean, how are we gonna do like education? How are we gonna teach online? But nowadays, everyone get used to it, and then we can do it better and better to make sure that online education can get students anywhere in the country. So for the IPST, Institute for the Promotion of Teaching Science and Technology, we focus on improving the quality of science, mathematics, and technology. We call it SMT, education through the development of innovative curricula and learning tools. And basically, we have a lot of projects during the past 3 years. One of the first projects that we have is what we call Project 14, which is an online session in SMT. We have a website, and we want to make sure that the learning is ubiquitous. So it's student can learn anywhere with a multi-device platform accessibility. So student and teacher can learn wherever they are, and then they can also interact with each other. We have the personalized learning. So the online lesson allows students to customize their learning. We have the conceptualized 2 educational videos based on the IPST approach that focuses on understanding the key concepts that are linked to the implementation. And then we have the standard core curriculum that we produce lessons based on indicators and standard core curriculum content, which is revised in 2017, as well as IPST textbooks. So basically, students can, they buy the textbook and then they can learn from this video clip without having to, you know, bother their teacher, because sometimes when they study with their teacher and they sometimes they don't get what the teacher trying to teach them, so they can just go to this website and then look for the video clip that they can learn according to the textbook that they have, okay? And then we also have another platform called MyIPST. This one is a learning management system for SMT classroom provided for both teacher and students. So they can learn a lot of things here because we have a lot of educational videos, presentations, learning activities, worksheets, quizzes, follow from the IPST textbooks, as I mentioned before. And also we also have the instructional guidelines for the teachers so that if the teacher don't know how to do with this material, then they can learn from that and then they can teach the students confidently. And then of course it's personalized learning. So teacher, if both teacher or students, they go log into this website, they can learn it on their own pace. And then besides those things, we also have the innovative curriculum for the computing science in K-12 education. For the primary education, grade 1 to 6, we try to get the students to solve problems with logical reasoning. They have to design and do basic programming with block coding software. And they're gonna be using ICTs for communication and collaboration. And lastly, they're gonna learn how to protect their personal information, rights and responsibilities to themselves and to the others. And this has a picture of some of the textbook that we produce. And also for the secondary education from grade 7 to 12. So basically we want them to develop their own projects, applications, or solutions to solve problems creatively, integrate with other disciplines. They have to analyze, compare, and select appropriate technologies to enhance society's economies and environmental impacts. And they have to utilize technology safely and with consideration of intellectual property. So they enjoy it a lot, and we have been using it for like 2 or 3 years, and they have come up with a lot of good projects. And we also have a competition like in nationwide. So they come up with a very good project that we can use it. Besides that, we also have the teacher training and seminar workshop to make sure that teachers are able to teach their students in computing science and also in data science. For the basic level, we have the coding for teachers, fundamental for both primary and secondary. And we also have coding for all, like coding issue is now in Thailand, it's like a very big issue that everyone can learn coding. We use it, we have this curriculum for everyone on Thai massive open online course, or we call it Thai MOOC. So we wanna make sure that everyone can have like lifelong learning. And for intermediate to advanced, we have a lot of program like creative microcontroller and programming. We have unplugged coding. Unplugged coding means they learn how to solve problem without using like software or programming. Just start doing it step by step. They learned it before they do programming, okay? And we have like programming with Scratch, which is like a web-based application. And also we have like artificial intelligence online training courses for schools. We have Python programming, which is like very boom, very, very fascinating programming right now, because it's open for everyone and it's good for computing science. And we also have a robot camp for teachers and students. We have data science and data and with Utunoi, the word Utunoi means weather forecast. So basically this application student would learn how the weather forecast can use the information that they have a lot of data science that we can predict, that we can like forecast the weather. And then we have guidelines for instruction design to enhance technology competence. So last but not least, we look forward to the future of the education. So basically we want to integrate emerging digital technologies and pedagogical approaches into its curricula and learning resources. We want to promote value-based education to foster responsible and empathic world citizens. We want to create a strong and engaged in a learning community by providing educators and students with the resources they need to succeed. And last, we want to collaborate with schools, universities, and government agencies to create a dynamic learning ecosystem that meets the evolving needs of Thai students and all educators. And so I'm more than welcome to answer any question if you might have. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Thiradet, for the insights and information shared with us. The role of technology and values driven is certainly an important factor that we need to brainstorm on a regular basis with all relevant stakeholders in the future. And we are certainly excited to know that Ministry of Thailand has initiated 5 initiatives which are on air, on site, online, on hand, and of course, on demand. It is also nice to know that IPST has initiated the Project 14 on online lesson in SMT. We are certainly happy to know how learning management system is being carried out. So thank you so much, Professor, for all the insights and ideas that you have shared with us. Now, let us welcome our second speaker for this session, Dr. Muhammad Hassan Chabibi, who is the Director of Center of Data and Information Technology from Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology of Indonesia. Let us give him a warm welcome for this session. Dr. Hassan, the floor is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. May peace be with us all, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, allow me to express my gratitude to CMIO in collaboration with the University of Tsukuba, Japan, for having me in this symposium. And secondly, I would like to extend my appreciation to our prominent speakers and panelists in this event who are going to share their knowledge and expertise. With the main theme of this discussion, technology and values driven transformation in education, allow me in this position representing Center for Data and Information Technology, or PUSDATIN, Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology, Republic of Indonesia, to share about a policy discussion on technology and values driven transformation in education. So let me share my screen. Okay. To support the values driven transformation in education, the Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology launched an initiative of Merdeka Belajar, or we call it Emancipated Learning, as one of the efforts to keep the spark of learning going. The philosophy of Merdeka Belajar is giving freedom and autonomy to educational institutions and to break free from ineffective bureaucracy, for example, eradicating complicated bureaucracy for teachers and lecturers in terms of administrative tasks and providing students with the freedom to choose their preferred fields. There are three big ideas underpinning the initiative of Merdeka Belajar. First, it embodies the spirit to developing technology-based education ecosystem from hardware, software, and humanware. And second, it encourages collaboration or multi-collaborative effort with all related stakeholders, focusing in improving learning and enhance the quality of education. And third, it utilizes data and technology innovation policy, framework, and learning strategy. The main goal of Merdeka Belajar is quality education for all, with all related stakeholders, including students, becoming agent of change and giving impact and support learning towards transformational organization, education technology-based company industry for high participation rate, and a quality learning outcome and equal distribution in the geographical and socio-economical context. For this to achieve, Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology sets a priority agenda to improve infrastructure and technology, to improve policy, procedure and funding, to improve leadership, society and culture, and to improve curriculum, strategy, pedagogy and assessment. So since 2021 until recently, there have been 22 episodes within the initiative of Merdeka Belajar. Next slide, please. Okay. Learning towards the philosophical underpinning of Merdeka Belajar, the value-driven transformation in education with technology aims at providing a way to build a strong foundation for Indonesian students to embody the values of Pancasila as a lifelong learner with global competence within six dimensions of characters, which is faith, fear of God, almighty, and noble character, global diversity, mutual cooperation or gotong royong, creativity, critical thinking, and independence. Okay, next slide, please. Along the way, Ministry of Education, Culture, Research and Technology has made adjustments to education policies and provide initiative, alternative, and programs as an effort to overcome educational challenge, including priority platform in the digitalization of initiator schools programs, or we call it Sekolah Penggerak. These platforms consist of platform for education assessment and evaluation, or in Indonesia we call it Rapor Pendidikan, And second, platform for administrative management for school resources. In Indonesia, we call it Arkas, Siplah, and Tanya Pos platform. The third, we call it a platform for competency-based career profiling or planning and development. In Indonesia, we call it Platform Merdeka Mengajar, and platform for independent and innovating teaching and learning, and also we call it platform Merdeka Mengajar. Next slide, please. Okay, from those platform, in this slide, there has been a lot of achievement that has been reached by each platform. For example, Merdeka Belajar has been used more than 2.7 million user, and we have more than 55,000 content has been included in those platforms. And for Rapor Pendidikan, for example, has been used by more than 100,000 schools in Indonesia, has been accessed for those platform. And for example, Belajar ID has been used by more 3.2 million teachers, has been used Belajar.id platform. For the next platform, we can show from this slide, like Arka, Siplah, Kampus Merdeka, Tanya Pos, also used more by 217,000 schools has been accessed from this platform. And from this slide, you can show another achievement that has been accessed, like Siplah, Kampus Merdeka, and also Tanya Pos. Next slide, please. So, from what has been expressed in policy education and technology and value-driven transformation in education, we realize that it is important to note positively that with solid collaborative effort from all stakeholders for strengthening an education technology sector will inshallah create its endless possibility for innovation and creativity. Let's collaborate, innovate, and be creative together with technology in education for the betterment of Indonesia. I guess that's all that I can share for you today. Thank you for your kind attention. May peace be with us all. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hassan. It was certainly an engaging and inspiring session, especially on policy discussion on technology and values-driven transformation in education. Three crucial ideas that you have shared, which involves the Merdeka Belajar under the umbrella of quality education for all. You also shared priority platforms in the digitalization, which are key important factors that could upgrade the quality of education in our region. Dr. Hassan, thank you so much for your time and effort. And to continue our session, may I introduce the third and the final speaker for today's session, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Feng Chun-Miao is the Chief of Unit for Technology and Artificial Intelligence in Education at Education Sector UNESCO headquarters in Paris. He is also the professor of Beijing Normal University of China. Is leading programs of educational sector of UNESCO on technological innovation in education, including the development of AI competencies. Dr. Feng Chuan, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, dear moderator, and thank you, Director Etio and CMU colleagues for this invitation. It's my honor to join the ASEAN community and the CMU community to share what UNESCO is doing, especially from far away from the headquarters of UNESCO based in Paris. So I used to work in UNESCO Bangkok. I had been traveling around the CMU countries. So it's really, really my pleasure and honor to come back to join this session. At the same time, I also with the Japan a couple of times for the same topic. Thank you for joining force with CMU for organizing this very interesting and useful seminar. So upon request, I want to follow up on the digital transformation of education. While we are appreciating very, very much greatly all the presentations, looking backward to what we have done, we need to also look forward to what we should do in the very near future. So I will very quickly introduce you, our CMU colleagues and friends, to what UNESCO can provide to you from Paris, not only from Bangkok, on steering the public digital learning, especially focusing on the policy and also including the platform. At the same time, I will present a framework very quickly. Recently, I come up with and on the digital transformation of education. And also, I will focus on one project to share with you. First of all, UNESCO usually has identified four basic foundations for its mandates. We call ourselves International Standard Setter. We also call ourselves, sometimes we call it simply think tank, more like CMU. And we call it Laboratory of New Ideas. And of course, we are the commander of international cooperation. At the same time, as we have been cooperating with the CMU and CMU countries, we are also providing quite a lot of capacity building, especially for the building and the development of national capacity. And this one dimension is the four key functions. The other dimension is the key areas relating to digital learning, or traditionally, I mean, you are still calling it ICT in education. So it includes the sector-wide ICT education, or we can call it sector-wide digital learning. But also we need to think of the emerging areas, including AI and also including open educational resources, if we are talking it from the content perspective. And the other emerging technology, including blockchain, I know that Indonesia has been doing very well with the leadership of the minister in the area of using blockchain. We also, under the AI, we also know that we have the ChatGPT and many, many more than ChatGPT. And we also have other emerging technology like the metaverse. So we need, from education perspective, we need to think how we can steer the policy to make the best use of this kind of emerging technology. So this is another dimension. These are the key areas. Based on these two key areas, we have producing quite a lot of resources to help the countries. First of all, we are not only talking about the series. Over the last almost 20 years, UNESCO have been supporting more than 70 countries in developing the ICT education policy, including quite a few countries present earlier. Indonesia, we organized a workshop, national workshop on the national ICT education policy. I think almost all the CMU countries we have organized, in addition to Singapore, usual Singapore, did not need UNESCO so much. But Malaysia, Philippines, Indonesia, Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, I personally all went there and organized this workshop. And based on this kind of workshop and support and cooperation with the countries, we try to develop some instruments. For example, we have a recommendation on OER, and we have a recommendation on ethics of AI, and we also have a consensus on AI and education. And based on the practice and these instruments, we produced, I call it 3+1 UNESCO policy guidelines on digital learning. I'm very proud because we are the only one UN agency that have produced guidelines on all the important areas of digital learning, including guidelines for ICT education policy and master plan, guidelines on the development of OER policy, and also guidance on AI and education. And very recently, we published another book, Education and Blockchain. So those are the support and also instruments and the guidelines. But at the same time, we are not forgetting the grassroots practice, just like what you presented minutes ago. We have been collecting best practice from the we call it a grassroots community. Also in line with these three areas. For ICT education, we have this toolkit. And we also have the database of national policy of different countries. At the same time, we have a prize, a UNESCO prize for ICT education. We've published this book with 24 prize winning projects over 12 years. And we also have the case study on the use of distance learning during COVID from Finland, Korea, and Saudi Arabia. We also have 14 best practices in mobile learning. At the same time, for AI, we have a compendium of best practice for 2 years. with more than 80 best practices. At the same time, we are the first organization that map the 193 member states K-12 AI curriculum. We published the report last year. And we also have case studies on OER policies and the initiative. We published this book. So that's the, largely what we can offer to member states. Just to give you an example, we have these guidelines. We use this one to help, as I said, 17 countries, including almost 10 similar countries. And we highlight the humanistic principle. We put forth a kind of sector-wide approach to the national ICT education policy. And we layer all the key areas of ICT education. And then we try to promote that we should use ICT to expand access to learning, improve quality, enable lifelong learning, and enhance management, including develop digital competency. And we also put forth some mechanism for the implementation. We will not go to the detail. And based on this, we are going forward to a future. So last year during the Transform Education Summit organized by the UN Secretary, Mr. Guterres, we launched a gateway to public digital learning. And this one from UNESCO and UNICEF and other UN agency, we want to produce a kind of global gateway, just like you present the platform. We want to have a global platform. At the same time, if possible, we have a coalition of platforms. And we also want to develop a standard for the digital learning, especially for the digital learning platform. And now we are planning a kind of survey on the national digital learning platform. And we also want to select and share best practices, especially what you present from the previous two presentations. At the same time, we are planning to organize the annual digital learning week. And largely we want to launch this digital learning week in September because we have been organized Mobile Learning Week for 9 years. We want to change it to Digital Learning Week from this year. So that's very quick news about that. And for AI and education, again, we have two dimensions. One is the key area. We are supporting AI and education policymakers through the consensus, through the guidance, but also through workshops. I think in 2019, we organized the first sub-regional workshop on AI and education in Indonesia together with the CMU. And we are producing ethical principle on the use of AI education. We're also developing an AI competency framework for teachers and also for students. And we will try to promote the use of AI as a public good for education. We already distributed a survey. We are collecting data. And we have been organizing 4 international conferences over 4 years. First of all, we are the only one UNGC that have organizing international AI and education conference for 4 years. Last year it was December. This year it should be in-person meeting, likely to be organized in China. And come back to the digital transformation of education. I believe that the digital transformation is not happening in the vacuum. It's happening in a big context of, I call it technology-driven civilizational transformation. It's not a simple use of technology or ICT or digital technology in different areas. We are facing, everybody of us here, every country of us are facing a huge technology-driven civilizational transformation. And from this side, the use of digital learning education, first of all, is a responsive reaction. It's not something like the proactive, towards the digital provision of management and also the provision of learning. Secondly, we have some proactive reaction from education is the development of human resources or the humanism values. And the third one is that we need to think how we can mobilize education and research to steer the reconstruction of a digital social order. This part very, 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 very often is ignored, completely ignored by this community. We are ignoring the transformation, or we can call it the reconstruction of a digital social order. So that's my understanding. Why I call it a technology-driven civilizational transition. If we look back to the history, all the technology-driven civilizational transition has this 5 elements or 5 steps. First of all, suddenly a human or 13 group of human, found or discovered a technology leap. For example, in the history, we start from the crude weapons to the hot weapon. You know, before you needed to be very powerful to use, for example, a sword to kill people. And once we have the hot weapon, the gun, you know, if you can only trigger the gun, you can kill people. You know, we have a technology leap. And then the entry level skills is very much lower, as I said. Before you need to use a sword to kill people. Now you can only trigger the gun, you can kill people. Now the entry level for the digital learning is you click the keyboard or click the mouse. Now even you sleep on the mobile phone. So the entry level skills is very much low. And then because the entry level skill is very much low, however, large scale social mobilization, we mobilize the large number of the society, almost everybody. And then to respond to this, we reconstructed the system, the laws, regulations, you know, it's all more like the legal reaction to the change of the productivity. And then because a certain group of people master these skills, they start to kill people to overcome the other civilization. And then in the history, we have the civilizational traditions. If you look at this, the digital technology have all these elements. So I deeply believe that the digital technology is not only the use of technology across sector, is triggering a new round of civilizational transition. We should not ignore. Very often we ignore this context. With this, we will find what are the key elements of the digital transformation of education. First of all, we need to really, really identify what are the aims, what are the results, especially what's the historical purpose of a digital transformation for your country, for our country. And then what's the upgrading of the digital infrastructure? We are talking about the higher dimensions of technology. We are not talking about the updating of infrastructure at the same dimension. The technology reached the high dimension. We need to think how we can upgrade the infrastructure, digital infrastructure to a high dimension. It's completely different from buying more computers or have a more speedy internet. It's very much kind of move from this dimension to an upper dimension. And then we should not talk about the low level, entry level skills. We need to talk if this country, if this group of civilization want to catch up, what kind of high level digital competency we need to develop? What kind of digital innovation all the civilization, not only Japan, not only Korea, not only China, all the countries, what kind of innovation we should have? We cannot wait that US come, Japan come, Korean come to give us technology. They will not give. They will ban the technology from us. So we have to have our innovation. And then we need to think how we can transform the public digital education system. It's not only to have a multiple platform. It's really a reform of education system from the only in-person public digital. Because when we talk about the public education system, we are thinking of schools, campus, teachers, textbook, curriculum. But in the future, it should be hybrid. It's more like the car. Before, when we think of car, the engine is engine. Now the engine is a hybrid engine. That's right. Within the future, the engine of that education should be hybrid. One, traditional, the other, digital. So we need to reform the public digital education system. And relating to this, we are feeling the social order is completely changed. So I have a lot of humanistic concerns. I summarize 10 humanistic concerns, and then I come up with the 10 value principles to counterbalance this humanistic concern. First of all, you can see that the digital transformation of education is the secondary transformation. It's not the primary in the sectors. The primary happened in the economy. It happened in the commerce, in the banking, in the military. We are not. We are the secondary sectors. We must acknowledge that. There's no way for education to be the primary. And then very much passive. That's the first principle. And to counterbalance this, we need to think of the digital equity among countries. And then all countries need to think of the digital autonomy. The digital autonomy is not about not only about China, not only about Japan, not only about Korea. It's about every country. And the second one, you can see that the technology is disrupting us. It's a disruptive technology. And also we have a technology monopoly. Technology monopoly means no matter how many platforms, how many technology we are talking about, only so far, only around three companies are really, really dominating this area, Google, Microsoft, and Apple. Because only these three companies, they have the entire life chain of the technology, from chips, from processor. No other company have chips. Secondly, they have the cloud solution. No other company have so large scale of the clouding service. And they have the operating system. How many countries, how many government company have an operating system? So far, only three. And then they have the platform, and then they have the application. So this kind of technology monopoly, we need to think of the digital inclusion and the digital public good to use and to develop digital public good. Not so many countries are thinking of the digital public good. This is not a new term. This term was proposed by the Secretary General of UN 3-4 years ago. So we need to pay attention to what does mean digital public good, how we can develop, how we can use. The third one, my concern is that it's not about a digital empowerment in the beginning. All the digital companies, they want to have a digital unintelligence. They want all the people to be stupid. Only click, click, slip, slip, use their application, become their consumer. They're not so keen to develop digital skills. We from education system should think of the digital empowerment. And then they try to have a colonization. You know, underlying the applications. Are they really, really promoting Bahasa Indonesia, Bahasa Malay? No, they are promoting English. They are eliminating Bahasa. They are eliminating the indigenous language of a similar country. We need to have, endogenous innovation and innovative application. And then the other ones, as I mentioned, I call it a digital parity, meaning that digital and the real world are not so much real world dominating digital world supplement. Now digital and real are parity and a parity solution. And I mentioned they are hybrid. And then so far, all the use of AI and almost all the digital use, digital learning is a kind of exogenous, which means external driven kind of dynamics. We need to think of digital real parity and endogenous innovation. And very, very seriously is that we have the algorithm society and we have the platform society. We're not paying attention to it. The platform are dominating. Before, everybody was talking about the platform. They are dominating our daily life. They are forming our, we call it digital subjectivity and also digital objectivity. And our digital subjectivity will influence our subjectivity in the real world. And we need to think of the ethics, and also I call it a digital social order. So for this, we need to promote this initiative. First of all, every country need to think of digital strategy autonomy and the autonomy-driven digital transformation of education. And we need to think of the digital publication for education and the strategic digital infrastructure. And then think of the lifelong and the life-wide digital empowerment and also the digital talent for every country, not only waiting, as I'm once again waiting for other countries, not only Singapore, not only Malaysia. Even I know that Indonesia is catching up, but every country should foster digital talent and then public digital education system and enable the endogenous innovation, especially endogenous use. And we need to think of the ethics and also the humanistic digital social order. So with this, I need to conclude, if we look at the digital transformation, it's from the digitization of information, digitalization of existing workflow, come to the digital transformation, we call the creation of a new digitalized business model. So with this, actually from UNESCO, we are summarizing that there's one trend. You know, we are more or less have a kind of introverted provision. We try to align all the key features of the provision of the platform of digital learning, including curriculum alignment, centralized platform, pedagogical innovation, and human coaching, to use human coaching to supplement digital offer and the digital provision. But also we need to have a kind of open access, including open listening, inclusive access, and we call it also platform. This platform is the operational system, agnostic accessibility. And also we need to think of the ubiquitous learning and also ubiquitous human interaction. Based on this, we are from UNESCO promoting a kind of a digital open school model, try to integrate platforms, content, and connectivity to offer and to enable the school-based use, but also home-based digital learning, but also the access to online content and online human coaching anytime, anywhere. We call it a digital open school. And we are implementing two quite large projects. We have up to 10 million US dollar to implement and test it in Africa. So we are reaching tens of thousands of students. So with this, I want to conclude my presentation. Thank you again for your time. This, my email is very simple. If you want to continue the discussion, we also have a website. I personally have LinkedIn and also ResearchGate if we will continue the discussion. I'm sorry, I used too much time. I thank the patience of the moderator and also the attention of the audience. Thank you very much. Once again, my honor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Feng Chuan, for expounding on the context and importance of the digital transformation of education towards public digital learning. Thank you so much. You shared with us significant areas of cooperation from the UNESCO's perspective, which include UNESCO's resources on steering the public digital learning. The Digital Transformation of Education Framework and UNESCO project on digital open schools as well. The UNESCO's efforts on AI and digital transformation is certainly a significant information for our dear audience and all participants. We are glad to know the workshops that your team and you have carried out in most countries in Southeast Asia has been successful. We really, truly, and sincerely appreciate all your information and effort in setting brave new standards in Southeast Asia. Thank you so much once again, Doctor. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have received almost 75 questions from the participants. But the question that the Secretariat has selected for the policy discussion session is from our participants via Q&A form. Now, without further ado, may I kindly request the Secretariat to post the question that we have received from the audience, please. So the question is, what are the key success factors at the policy level in driving technology and values transformation across educational levels? I think this is an interesting question. May I ask probably Dr. Feng Chuan to start off by giving your 1 minute explanation, please. Doctor, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I think this question has been asked by many, many of my colleagues because as I mentioned, among the 70 countries, I organize around 40 workshops. For each of the workshops, it's 5 days. We work with 25 to 30 policymakers like you, and even the director general, sometimes the vice minister of education from the country, 25 to 30 policymakers. To me, I think the most important thing is that we need to really, really, I did not have the time this for this presentation. I think we need to reflect a keyword, I call it digital humanism. Digital humanism is the further evolution of the humanism that was originated from the industrial age. You know, if from the industrial age, we are thinking of the humanism. Now we are reaching the digital era. We think of the digital humanism, which means what kind of humanism, what kind of humanistic values we need to insist on when we are using digital learning or introducing digital technology to the education. So what kind of values we should maintain them and we should not abandon them? And then what are the new values we need to add to education, to learning, and also more importantly, to the humanity? For example, take a very, very recent example is the ChatGPT. When we are using ChatGPT, what are the humanistic principles we should think? The ChatGPT, to me, the only one purpose, only one value is to provoke critical thinking. To provoke critical thinking. For this, the most important thing is the human's agency. We should not forget teacher agency, student agency. We, human, are the agency to understand knowledge, to use knowledge, to create knowledge, to exchange knowledge. We should not give our right, our agency to technology. That's right. So these kind of values which must set up. Without this kind of digital humanistic value, all kinds of digital learning, digital transformation of education must fail, no exception. To me, this is the most important thing. To do this, of course, we have a lot of implementation strategy. But to me, the implementation strategy, one of the most important things is the governance, or the we call the steering. The government must have a very clear steering mechanism or governance mechanism, including the governance of ethics, but also the governance and coordination perspective across a different sector. So to avoid the conflict of the values, conflict of the actions. So there's a lot of other sector, successful sector, I will not repeat, but I think the values and the steering or the governance to me are very, very important. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your ideas and response. Thank you so much, Doctor. We really appreciate that. Now, shall I pass the floor to Professor Thiradat for a response as well? Professor, the floor is yours, Professor.
Thank you. So for me, I think the key success factors consist of three components: leaders, teachers, and students. So for the leaders, I think they need to perform the leadership and networking to find a way in helping the students learning and also give a better infrastructure, like for example, for the internet and smart devices. And for the teacher, I think they have to be determined to retain and reskill the new knowledge in order to be able to use to apply the technology in their learning and teaching technique. And for the students, I think they supposed to be able to adjust themselves and be eager and willing to learn in the new technology, new environment. And I think the student can do like can learn really quickly. And once they enjoy doing it, they enjoy learning with new technology, I think their learning skill will go up fast. Thank you.
Leaders, teachers, and students. Well, thank you so much, Professor. And I believe these informative responses from our respective speakers have certainly answered the question above. I believe we have come to an end here. I would love to thank and thank you so much to all the distinguished speakers. We really, truly, and sincerely appreciate your dedication, devotion, and determination in forging forward our goals to upgrade the quality of education. Thank you so much, dear speakers. And I also would love to thank our online participants, particularly from YouTube, who have been extremely cooperative for this session. And with that, I would pass the floor back to our secretariat. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Kamas, for moderating the session. And thank you to all the speakers for a very insightful policy discussion on technology and values-driven transformation in education. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now proceed with the next session. But before that, allow me to remind you that we have provided the Q&A form for any questions or reflections that you may have to our speaker. So you can either scan the QR code, which appears on the screen right now, or click on the link, which appears on the chat box and on the description box on YouTube. Okay, so now let us begin with session two, which focuses on technology and values-driven transformation in lifelong learning and holistic education. Without further ado, may I invite Professor Nomura Nagao, Regional Director for Southeast Asia, Bureau of Global Initiatives from University of Tsukuba, Japan, once again to moderate the session. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Welcome to the session two. And we will focus on the lifelong learning and holistic education in line with the topic of this symposium, which is technology and value-driven transformation in education. Okay, so we have four speakers from four countries. I hope we learn a lot from the presentation from four speakers. I would like to invite the first speaker. She is from Germany. Let me introduce her, Ms. Edith Hammer, Program Specialist in UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning, Germany. Ms. Edith, floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for this opportunity to contribute to the 11th Senior University of Tsukuba Symposium. There is a very timely and important topic of this symposium, technology and values-driven transformation in education, which I'm sure will bring great value to rethinking education and lifelong learning. And to start with, I would like to remember ourselves of the major global challenges that the global community is facing today. and how the education system can respond to these. So we can see major changes in the world of work due to digitalization, robotics, automation, artificial intelligence, and this will require people to reskill and upskill throughout their lives. And this means that they need to also build the ability of learning to learn throughout life. Demographic change, another so-called global megatrend, aging societies in large parts of the world, but also internal and transnational migration requires new demands for education systems. We need to address the needs of older learners, but also imply intergenerational approaches, bringing the generations together through learning processes, and address the needs of displaced persons in the education system. We can also observe critical issues related to global citizenship and building global solidarity. The education system also has an important mission to fulfill in this sense, in enhancing social cohesion within local communities, but also creating a sense of belonging together as a humanity and addressing the major challenges together, building agency in people. When it comes to global health issues, well, the pandemic has really had a global effect on global health, and it made clear once more that we need to build the skills for, in the one hand, for people working in the medical sector, in the health sector, but also for people to take care of themselves to maintain their well-being. When it comes to new digital technologies, of course, this is highly important for people's professional lives, but digital technologies really also transcend all and living environments, all fields of life, and so basic and advanced ICT skills to make use of the technologies available, but also to create and build these technologies and online environments will be very critical and foundational skills for people in the future. And then last but not least, and really this is the probably most important crisis that the global community is facing today, is the climate crisis, which needs urgent actions at all levels of government. And it also requires building new skills, building green skills for leading the transition towards greener economies and societies, for economies that are based on low carbon practices of production and also consumption. But this also means building resilience in communities, enabling communities to deal with the impacts of climate change, which are expected to further increase over the next years and decades to come. So we currently can see a particular momentum for transforming education and also implying a rights-based approach to lifelong learning. Following the vision of the 2030 agenda to leave no one behind and taking serious the commitment of SDG 4 to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all, the right of education must be renewed, that we need a right to lifelong learning. We need to recognize lifelong learning as a human right that applies to people around the globe. And there is now a new momentum to reinforce this ambition. In June last year, the 7th International Conference on Adult Education and Learning, CONFINTEA 7, the global community made a commitment with the adoption of the Marrakesh Framework for Action to harness the transformation and power of adult education and learning. And in doing so, it really applied a lifelong learning perspective. And last autumn, the United Nations Transforming Education Summit expressed a new political ambition and sense of solidarity. It agreed, the participants agreed on specific actions and solutions to transform education and revitalize national and global efforts to achieve SDG 4. And in a recent report, the UN Secretary General, the report is entitled Our Common Agenda. He has called for a universal entitlement to lifelong learning and reskilling, translated into practice through legislation, policy, and effective lifelong learning systems. It is a call to member states that was also reaffirmed in the Marrakesh Framework for Action last year. So we can see there is a very conducive political global discussion and environment now for transforming education. And the question is, how can we make that happen? Well, one way that has proven to be very effective is the concept of learning cities, and building learning cities is a way to enhance participation in lifelong learning and to contribute to the creation of sustainable living environments. Learning cities operate very much under the umbrella of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And learning cities are a particularly important link to link these global discussions, the global goals that are ongoing for sustainable development, but also, as mentioned, these global discussions on transforming education, to link these with local action, with local communities. And local governments are the closest levels of governments to the people. They have a better understanding often of local issues, of how education can respond to these local issues. So learning cities are indeed highly critical in making the concept of lifelong learning a reality. Learning cities mobilize institutions and community groups to provide lifelong learning opportunities for all. And local governments cannot do this on their own. Lifelong learning is a holistic concept that happens in formal education, but very importantly, also in non-formal learning environments and through informal learning. And this requires a broad involvement and commitment by a multitude of stakeholders. So municipal governments obviously are important leaders for learning city environments, but also we have seen universities and higher education institutions making relevant contributions to building learning cities, sometimes even leading these initiatives. Community organizations, youth representatives, and NGOs need to be involved as they represent the needs, the learning needs of people, and have a good awareness of the local issues. Cultural institutions, museums, and libraries provide valuable learning environments and need to be involved. Schools, TVET institutions. This means particularly also creating linkages between the different sectors of the education system. And of course, employers and employer representatives are highly important to ensure that learning also translates into viable job opportunities for people. So within these multitude of stakeholders, I would like to zoom into the higher education sector to see what is the higher education sectors in making lifelong learning, implementing lifelong learning, and building learning cities. This is also related to research that UL has, the UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning, has conducted during the last years. We conducted a global survey, the results of which have been presented also last year at the World Higher Education Conference in Barcelona. And we also had several opportunities to present the survey results already. So I would not give a detailed account of our findings, but I would like to zoom into one of those results. Are currently being finalized and will be published within the next weeks, and also you can find the data through this stat link. And this result is particularly about universities or higher education institutions' engagement with local communities. And in the survey, which was answered by almost 400 institutions, 98% of higher education institutions stated that they engage with local communities in one form or another. And there is a variety of ways to do so. Indeed, offering public lectures and workshops was the most common form, but also collaborating with other universities, collaborating with cultural institutions, NGOs, research institutes, with schools, engaging with schools, providing those links from the transition to school to higher education, working, providing spaces for the intervention, learning intervention of other providers, And so we can see that universities indeed have already are strongly engaged with their cities and local environments. They are based on their traditions in providing teaching and education, but also research. They are really very well placed to support lifelong learning and build learning cities through their so-called third mission. And this is why we have also conducted thematically focused research on the role of universities to building learning cities, which will also be published by the end of this year or start of next year with Springer Open Access. So we are very pleased to make that available online for everyone. So to come slowly to the end, I would like to also refer to a recent publication by the UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning, which also provides this holistic sense of what lifelong learning means conceptually, but then also translates it into practice. It gives a good account of how the concept of lifelong learning can be translated into policies and mechanisms to make it work. It is a handbook for lifelong learning, and it provides a capacity building tool and a standard setting instrument for countries, for national governments, but also for local governments. It provides a variety of practical examples from countries around the world. And in the last chapter, it actually zooms into the concept of learning cities, providing an account of how local communities have been able to implement the idea of lifelong learning within their particular context, and also giving guidance on how other cities who are interested in the concept can make this work within their contexts. And the book is available in English, French, and Spanish. It is I include the link in the publication on the slide. So I really invite everyone who is interested to learn more about UNESCO's approach of the UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning towards transforming education and also advocating for the right to lifelong learning for everyone. So I thank you for your attention, and I wish all of you a fruitful and productive event, which I'm sure will bring great value to continuing the discussion on transforming education and lifelong learning for the future. Goodbye. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Adiz, for the very informative presentation. And I think your presentation provides a lot of information for those who are not familiar with lifelong learning as well. I think a few slides first, I think you pointed out some important points for lifelong learning, like workforce or demographic change and global citizenship and health, digital technology, and climate change. These six factors are quite important for lifelong learning since because lifelong learning is for the many levels of the people and many kinds of the people. So I think it was always something like eye-opening for the most of the people. And also that you emphasize on the building the learning city as an important point for the lifelong learning. But also you pointed out that this learning city cannot build by only one sector. It's a kind of the cooperative approach. So the local government, schools, and universities, and especially you pointed out the important role of the university. And like public lecture, university networking was really important. I think we learned a lot of things from your presentation. Thank you very much, Dr. Adiz. So I'd like to invite the next speaker for the second speaker for the next presentation. Next speaker is from CMEO has a specific center for the lifelong learning. We call CMEO Cell. And we have a special speaker from the Lifelong Learning Center for the CMEO, Mr. Kao Hu Pok, Research and Training Manager of the CMEO Regional Center on the Lifelong Learning, we call in shortly CMEO Cell. Okay, Dr. Kao, floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the very nice introduction. And can I share my screen now? So Secretary, can you allow me to share my screen? Okay, thank you. Works. So you see my screen now? Do you see my screen?
Yes, I can
see you very much. So I'll begin immediately so to save time so that we can have more time for the Q&A later. So within the theme, technology and value-driven transformation in education, we'd like to look at how the digital age has transformed the way we learn throughout our lives. I'll start with a short story. Once I was in the coffee shop, sipping some good smelling coffee, when I heard some giggling from a table near me. So I glanced sideways and I saw some young people. They were obviously having a good time because I could see smiles on their faces. But what was strange is that they were not smiling to each other. They were not talking to each other. Their eyes were glued to their phone screen. So I realized that they were on Facebook and having interesting moments with each other in that visual world. So the story that I just told you illustrates how much people are absorbed in the internet now. We are living in an internetic network of the internet. If you look at the chart on the right side of the slide, we can see that the internet penetration in different regions of the world. And of course, we can see that at the top is Europe, and then Commonwealth Independent States, and then America. Asia Pacific is a bit, is not very, very good here. However, the percentage is still above the average, 64%. So the internet has many applications. They are for information storage, information sharing, therefore communication. And within those two major categories, we use it for business, like email, product advertising, e-commerce. For education, like online classes, open education resources, and for management, for example, we have the learning management system, have video conferencing, the social participation, we can name immediately Facebook, YouTube, TikTok, etc. And for entertainment, streaming music and videos and many others, applications of the internet. So the idea of lifelong learning implies that we are flipping the way knowledge and skills are acquired. The traditional way is we bring the learners to school. Today, the internet is bringing school to the learners. The traditional way is the front-end model of education, that we start with kindergarten and we graduate high school or tertiary education, and then that's done. We can go to work and work effectively throughout our lives. I mean not our lives, but our grandparents' life. Today, with the development of the internet, science and technology, what we learn from high school, from university, must be updated within a year or two after our graduation. And that's why we need to lifelong learn. And so what is lifelong learning? Lifelong learning can be simply understood as learning that is conducted or that's carried out with the prefix any. Lifelong learning is learning for anyone. To learn anything at any time, anywhere, and anyhow, in any modes. And it is for people of any age, any speed, of any ethnicity, doing any job, and of any gender. So we can see that everybody now should and must practice lifelong learning. Then we have seen that lifelong learning, the internet has accelerated the need for lifelong learning. Then what values are promoted by education today and supported by the internet? The Dialogues report, the four pillars in the Dialogues report that were, still hold true today. We learn so that we can have knowledge about the world, we about ourselves, and understand how we where we are in this world. We learn knowledge and skills so that we can do things appropriately, culturally appropriately, ethically, and with responsibility. We learn so that we can live together with understanding, in harmony, and in peace. And we learn to live together so that we can have we can be sensible, responsible social beings. We can be contributing national and global citizens. If we split these up, we have the values that education is promoting today. For example, some of them are creativity, critical thinking, lifelong learning, social responsibility, etc. There are, of course, challenges in to every change, and digital transformation of education has challenges too. In the case of Vietnam, we face some major issues, and I would like to categorize them according to the five domains that UNESCO recommended for adult learning and education in 2015. The challenges are, number one, lack of appropriate policy for lifelong learning via digital means. Number two is insufficient funding from the government and insufficient involvement of the business sector. Number three is the digital divide among different groups of people, especially people of different financial background or people who live in different regions of Vietnam. And also, there is the problem of the low awareness of the role of lifelong learning, because people still emphasize on formal schooling. And the next one is the teacher digital competency. Well, not many teachers, not all teachers have the sufficient digital competency for teaching. And the learner's digital literacy, not everybody can use the digital device for learning and the program, and especially RVA, recognition, validation, and accreditation. I would like to elaborate a little bit on this one. So the traditional people awareness of the benefits of lifelong learning in Vietnam is not the same across social groups. Some people, especially those from the ethnic minority groups, believe that they have lived and worked like their ancestors through many generations, and they still survive. So what is the use of learning? They haven't realized that lifelong learning and learning learning throughout their lives will improve the quality of their lives. In what sense? Economically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually too. In addition, in the concept of lifelong learning is sometimes understood not correctly. Many people that I have talked to still believe that learning means going to school. They are not aware that learning can take place anywhere today. And also, the opportunities to study in Vietnam using the digital technology is not equal among these different social groups. Technology is increasingly supporting more educational activities and helps people to learn anywhere, anytime, as I said before, in a flexible manner that meets individual needs and condition. With digital technology, the idea of schooling is bringing to school to the learners, as I said before. However, access to digital technology is not equal. The digital gap is most evident with this disadvantaged group, with the elderly, with the communities living in remote and mountainous and regions on islands. And in Vietnam, there's still a lack of strong investment by the business community to promote lifelong learning. Very few businesses have policies or programs to support and create conditions for their employees to participate in lifelong learning activities. And in fact, the government has issued policies, but those are just at the level of encouragement. It's not compulsory. And therefore, lots of businesses do not care about that much. So I have talked briefly about the challenges in digital transformation in Vietnam. And in Vietnam, what can we do? What can we do to promote lifelong learning in a sense in this digital world? Number one, issue supporting policies to motivate teachers. By teachers here, I'm thinking more about the teachers or the facilitators in community learning centers. The pay is not good enough, are not encouraging. And next one, involve all stakeholders for lifelong learning promotion. And ensure that everyone can access the internet. So with this, the government should have policies that encourage the technical company business enterprises in technology to join in the effort, in the initiative of providing digital devices and condition to all the learners. And next one is enhanced labor mobility among CMEO countries. With this, why do I think about this? Because with enhanced labor mobility among CMEO countries, people will feel the need to learn more and more so that they have the enough skill to work in another country. And so in that case, they will be motivated to learn, to keep learning. Next one is organize various lifelong learning activities throughout the year to increase awareness. In Vietnam, we have the Lifelong Learning Week. We have the book reading day. But these take place once a year. We need to organize this more frequently so that lifelong learning will become a common practice of the people. And apply technology to education management and train and retrain teachers in using digital technology for teaching. So all this, if I have neglected the governance points on the governments, because it is rather complicated. We need to explain more. I need to explain more about the governments before I can make the recommendations here. And therefore, I just skip it. Yeah. So with that, I thank you, all of you, for your attention. And thank you very much, the organizer, for allowing me this opportunity to share my thinking with the audience. And I will develop my presentation into a full paper and submit it to the symposium. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kuo. Okay. I think your presentation started an interesting story. That's interesting to me because I have a similar experience in Japan. I see those people a lot in Japan as well. And I believe other participants in this symposium have a similar experience. And I think your presentation focused on the digital technology and lifelong learning. and the positive and negative impact on that one. And the positive impact, I think it's very clear that I think if we can provide lifelong learning more to the different level of the people by using digital technology, but you spend more time on the negative impact, like you said, challenges. And these challenges really we need to address. And your presentation pointed at many points, like many minorities in the remote area or the gap in the opportunities, many things. I think we learned a lot from your presentation. Thank you very much, Dr. Kok. Okay, well, I'd like to invite the next speaker. Next speaker is from Malaysia. Okay, Dr. Noor Hisham bin Ismail. He's a principal assistant director, International Education Planning Unit of Ministry of Education. Okay, let's welcome Dr. Noor Hisham. Floor is yours. I think your microphone is muted.
Can I check if the screen is my slide?
Now you're audible. Okay. I can see your slides now.
Okay, hold on.
Okay.
I need to. If you can just give me a couple of seconds.
Okay, no problem.
All right. Let me check this. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Moderator, and assalamu alaikum and a very good afternoon, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. Let me now share the significance of holistic education in Malaysia and a little bit about one of our initiatives that Ministry of Education embarked on under the umbrella of holistic education in Malaysia. Next slide.
Excuse me, I think your presentation file is not in the slideshow mode yet.
Oh, okay. All right. Is it in... It's
yeah, that one. You can click on that one. Yes.
All right.
Okay. Okay.
Now it's okay.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Okay. Let me start over. Okay, the Prime Minister of Malaysia has recently outlined a robust policy framework that proposed six core values, namely SCRIT, which stands for sustainability, care and compassion, respect, innovation, prosperity and trust. So this policy framework addresses on shaping and building a thriving, dynamic future for better Malaysia. So the Ministry of Education Malaysia too has envisioned seven trusts of education to cultivate a harmonious educational ecosystem in which focus on communication, the formation of manners, moral integrity, poverty, dropout issues, teachers, schools, and also digital education. And Malaysian Education Blueprint 2013-2035 is currently is in the final wave of its implementation, and it has achieved a notable progress. So it is also in tandem with the UNESCO's Sustainable Development Goal 4, which optimize access, quality, equity, unity, and efficiency. We realize in our quest of producing a just Malaysian society, along with the rapid changes in technology, we now need to prepare our young for a very different future. So driven by new policy framework and thrusts, Malaysia needs to reprioritize the education landscape. So the world of education has changed and will continue to change rapidly. Skills or knowledge today will be different for tomorrow. Ladies, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, Malaysia encourages the development of lifelong learning abilities, sustainable innovation capabilities in our education system as part of our transformation efforts. So in today's interconnected and pluralistic society, it is imperative to educate pupils to appreciate interconnectedness, differences and also empathic to the various needs of society. So digital pervasiveness, environmental forces and demographic changes have shaped our pupils' life. So against this backdrop of an increasingly globalized and interconnected world, and amidst the calls for education to promote peace, well-being, prosperity, and sustainability, interest in holistic education that focuses on development of non-cognitive skills has been growing. So the changing global landscape has also motivated countries across the globe to initiate measures to integrate into curricular, non-curricular activities, non-cognitive skills. And these skills are referred to motivation, integrity, interpersonal interaction, which are the affective and behavioral aspects of learning. So Malaysia has always placed the development of non-cognitive skills as a critical part of its aim to develop a holistic education system. It needs to develop holistic individuals, and is this is affirmed in the Malaysia Education Blueprint, which defines success only when every student leaves schools as a global citizen imbued with core universal values and a strong Malaysian identity. So various initiatives have been put in place through formal and informal setting, curricular and extracurricular interventions, and conventional and also unconventional pathways to ensure students development do not only focus on the cognitive aspect, but equally important, the non-cognitive aspects of education. So as part of Loop East policy initiatives in basic education, Malaysia has been working under the Technical Cooperation Program with Japan International Cooperation Agency, JICA, on a special project called Makmur, or Memperkasakan Amalan Kemenjadian Murid, or in English, we call it fostering students' positive values. So, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, despite significant progress in achieving the aims of the National Education Philosophy and the aspiration of Malaysia Education Blueprint, MOE believes further efforts are essential to ensure more conducive and positive learning environment for child growth. So Malaysia believes much can be learned from the Japanese education system, in particular, the implementation of Tokubetsu Katsudo or Takatsu, or special activities which nurtures and foster positive values in an integrated whole school approach system. So based on this, the Ministry of Education has proposed a Makmur to further strengthen the existing practices in Malaysian schools. So through the process of enhancing the Malaysian education environment in order to promote students' potential and grow their characters. So through this combination of three elements, thought, feelings, and behavior, this process will be the foundation for students' growth throughout their lives. So these three elements are the cause of Makmur, which align with the aim of existing national education philosophy. The three Makmur elements shall be integrated to ensure that students are able to enhance their skills and potentials as a whole. So the first element is thought, where the ability to learn, understand, and think and reflect creatively, innovatively, and critically to overcome challenges and make informed decisions in life. So media literacy, entrepreneurship, and also educational skills are also part of this element. Secondly, feeling, which refers to the positive emotions that are acquired and nurtured through conscious practices over time to develop good character. So this includes self-initiatives, awareness, empathy, perseverance, social and cultural skills, as well as also appreciating differences and diversity. Thirdly, behavior, where actions that reflect continuous effort to adapt and react to the environment rationally. So these include collaboration and communication skills, shared responsibility, maturity in making decisions, risk-taking, resilience, and also global competence. So the overarching goal of Project Makmur is to determine the feasibility of the process of integrating non-cognitive skills into teaching and learning, paying close reference to the concept of Takatsu into existing practices in schools, so as well as in the some introduction of new practices. The process of transformative, in this project is very transformative and seeks to develop the and inculcate the competencies and skills by number one, aligning concepts of non-cognitive skills, in particular the Takatsu key concepts, into existing practices in school, students demonstrating behavioral change in their daily activities in schools and beyond, and thirdly, change the teacher practices, which focuses on student-driven, experiential, and cooperative learning. Ladies and gentlemen, we use plan, do, reflect spiral process model in this project to ensure that the process cycle will be continuous and also sustainable. The principles of Makmur, when we talk about principles of Makmur, teachers need to strive in making sure that the main principles of Makmur are always practiced by the students during their daily activities. So all three principles are the core of Makmur implementation. We have number one, learning through experience, where students are given the opportunity to execute and experience activities with their friends. And the repeating process of these experiences will help students in enhancing their own skills and ability. Number two, we have self-motivation, where all activities of Makmur must be suggested by students themselves so that they are more motivated in solving problems and executing activities that have been discussed in group. Thirdly, equal opportunity. So all students must be given the opportunity to participate in all Makmur activities. Providing these opportunities are crucial so that all students go through similar experiences in rotation, at the same time helping each other at improving their own skills and ability. In order to ensure that principles of Makmur are constantly being practiced, all Makmur activities must include the following three criteria. Number one, value of mistakes. So in the process of implementing student-driven activities, mistakes may occur. So all those mistakes are changes, chances for students to be guided so that they can learn to improve themselves. In the case where an activity did not result in an expected outcome, teachers are encouraged to complement students' effort, and every student has their own skills that they can excel at, and it is crucial that teachers believe and celebrate that diversity. More importantly, the students go through the process of making and learning from mistake, and subsequently learn to improve their own skills and ability. The second criteria is student-driven, where students need to be encouraged so that they can develop self-motivation through all Makmur activities. Having their own self-motivation in addition to guidance from teachers can help students in achieving their goals as well as improving their behavior more positively. The level of students' guidance should vary accordingly to the development of students, whereas it is preferable to minimize the guidance, especially for the upper primary students. Third criteria of activities in Makmur is the opportunity for every student. All students must take part in the activities that are decided and implemented. All students must be given the opportunity to participate in rotation so that each student can learn to enhance their abilities at the same time, make and learn from their mistakes. Ladies and gentlemen, the preschool and primary schools are a crucial period in building foundation of students' growth throughout their lives. So during this period, Students will learn not only through study, but also by doing things that they find interesting and fun. So, and in this stage, students are guided by teachers in implementing more activities with the integration of the three elements, thought, feelings, and behavior. And a strong and sturdy foundation for students' growth at this stage will prepare students for the next step with a useful skills such as problem-solving skills. So students' enjoyment in all activities at school depend largely on the class environment that builds their characters. So in order to ensure the principles of Makmur are practiced inside and outside of the classroom, teachers should strive to create an ideal class environment. So with that note, we have been rather fortunate in Malaysia because our early proponent of education had the foresight that the wisdom to understand the value of creating an education system that focuses on development of individuals who possess academic as well as non-academic competencies. As a result, both of these competencies have been deeply embedded in the education system. However, over the decades, in our quest to progress and advance, we may have lost the sort of equilibrium between the development of academic and non-academic competencies. So this is where we realize that we have much to learn from the Japanese education system that has successfully maintained a balance between the development of knowledge and also character through its integrated approach to education, particularly the implementation of Takatsu. So hence, the birth of Makmur in our initiatives under the pillar of holistic education. With that note, I thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sham. I think your introduction of the new project called the Makmur, I think we learned a lot about that. And I'm glad to know that that's under collaboration between Japan. We do a lot of those activities, and I see a lot of the non-cognitive skill, one of the key for the Makmur. And I think the you elaborate more about those Makmur project and I think importance and the key factors, especially like learn through experience, self-motivated, equal opportunity. This is a very important thing. And it's important to let students have fun, enjoy. Then they can do self-motivated. I think that's really important factor for the non-cognitive skill. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for the introduction, the Makmur and presentation. Okay, so I'd like to welcome the next speaker. Next speaker is from Japan, the Professor Kawaguchi Jun from School of Human Sciences, College of Education, University of Tsukuba, Japan. I think his presentation was a bit related with Dr. Sham's presentation about the non-cognitive skill. Okay, let's welcome Dr. Kawaguchi, Professor Kawaguchi. Floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor. So I'd like to share my slide. Can you see it? Okay.
Okay, I can see now.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay. Well, you can see, but I cannot see it. Okay. My presentation title is How Do We Foster Non-Cognitive Skills with the Children? Sorry, last minute I changed the title a little bit. Sorry for making trouble, CMO of the University of Tsukuba. Here is my contents, the first background, and the second, what's non-cognitive skills. But I think most of you know already these matters. That is, I'd like to focus on number three and number four this time. How do we foster them, in fact? Of course, you know the definitions or contents of the concept of non-cognitive skills, but then maybe you agree with the importance of non-cognitive skills, but how do we foster, in fact, in the classroom or outside classrooms? Then how do we evaluate them? So these points are today's focus. Okay, briefly, just briefly, I'll show the background. That, as you know, we already entered the society 5.0. It's called the VUCA era, VUCA world. Then, so this world is volatility is increased, uncertainty complexity, the ambiguities, this world, of course, COVID-19 or artificial intelligence or climate change, these problems we face, then traditional education, requested students are required to memorize the knowledge that is given to them by teachers. Then a good student remember the contents of textbook. This is a best student. Then as a result, government or school produce good workers or eliminate individual characteristics or diminish creativities, like these things. Every student like same kind of robot. But in VUCA era, we need to foster the creativities or critical thinkings, collaboration skills, like these things. I've mentioned, students need to be able to adapt and work on questions, issues where there are no correct answers by utilizing knowledge. So before VUCA era, students can memorize the answer, specific answers. But from now, they need to create answers. Okay. That's the creative skills or learning skills, and of course, critical thinking skills. These skills are really important. And it's called the constructivism. The students need to construct knowledge by themselves independently. Of course, using some skills, some existing knowledge, but not just memorize existing knowledge, but also they need to create new knowledge, and they need to solve the problem. There are no correct answers. Okay, this is a background. Maybe, as you know, then non-cognitive skills are also, you already know that there are various types of definitions, like 21st century skills or competency skills, like these things, creativity, collaborations, communications, critical thinking. And OECD mentions the big five, openness to experience, conscientiousness, extraversions, agreeableness, neutralism, like these things, they defined as a non-cognitive skills. But this point is, of course, various types of definition. Point is these skills are relating each other. And based on some skills, like a collaboration skill, the communication skill, they can get upper skills or other skills. These are points. And yes, from now, the main point, how do we educate or foster non-cognitive skills? Yes, today I'd like to use one of the famous approach, the International Baccalaureate approach, the ATL. Approach to learning, like a thinking skills, self-management skills, communication skills, research skills, social skills. These things is approaches to learning. Okay. For example, the self-management skills, student need to have management skills. Of course, their fitness and time management or emotional control, or these things is management skills. Okay. Then schools or teacher need to teach how to manage these things, time management or emotional management, communication skill also, research skills also very important. And these are examples of content of each skills. Then point is, please look at the blue one. Teacher's role. Teacher give a meaningful feedback. Okay, so students can improve their skills. Before society 4.0, before VUCA era, teacher's job provides the existing knowledge, contents of knowledge, contents of textbook, okay, effectively or efficiently. But from now, teachers' jobs dramatically change, kinds of facilitators, and they need to encourage children to get non-cognitive skills, as well as cognitive skills, of course. Okay, let's see the examples. For example, if we like to host the critical thinking skills, what kind of questions we need to provide? Okay, so we need to make sure the question makes students consider a different perspective. Okay, so far by Society 4.0, students need to think same ideas, remember same content, but from now they need to consider the different perspectives, different values. Then they need to become more open to new ideas and perspectives. They need to welcome the different ideas, the different values. It's called the openness to experience, or open-minded, or maybe international mindedness. Then they can consider perspectives other than your own. Right, relatively, they can think it. And after that, they can understand others, different opinions, and collaborative skills and collaboration with others. So like these steps is important. The questions, the feedback also, we need to foster like these things, like this order. And the reflection by themselves is very important. They need to reflect what happened. So later I'll explain. That's it. So like these questions are really useful. Where is your opinion knowledge coming from? These questions about the source of knowledge, they need to make confirm the source of knowledge, not just a rumor or just the internet or not good. You know. We need to make sure it's a source of knowledge. And how is these opinions and knowledge or maybe values being constructed? The methods of acquiring knowledge is also important. And what's influencing the way that you think? The questions about the biases also very important questions. Then students themselves need to have a metacognitive ideas. The sense of metacognition is really important. Okay, then metacognitions, there are three steps. First, they need to get the knowledge, how knowledge is formed, the different type of knowledge. Then students need to understand how knowledge is not concrete. Then get better ideas, better understandings. Then improving communication skills, the problem solving skills. But problem solving skills is not non-cognitive skills. Problem solving skills are often misunderstood. Problem solving skills is a cognitive skills. In fact, cognitive skills, it's a definition. But non-cognitive skills and cognitive skills, it's not trade-off. It's help each other. In fact, lots of people, even professors, researchers, teachers misunderstand. If we host non-cognitive skills, cognitive skills is going down, but it's not true. If we provide non-cognitive skills, non-cognitive skills also improved. It's independent, right from Grana, adapt VUCA era. Okay, the reflection is a student, they need to think by themselves. Okay, what's the strong areas, what's the weak areas of themselves, even skills or emotions or abilities, anything. Okay, then on the other hand, they need to see others, their friends or parents or other people's strong points or weak points or methods of improvement. This is a reflection. And they need to think themselves in relation to others. The relationship with others is really important. And system thinking is also, it's really important. They need to reflect, how does my action affect others? How does someone else's actions affect me? What's the overall impact of our actions, right? These things. Okay, so the time thing. So I'd like to skip. So I'd like to share these slides. You can use anything. So these things is important, but I'd like to skip. Okay, the ways of reflection. Okay. There are various types of ways. Of course, writing sentences or essays or whatever, even sometimes poems is all right. Of course, some students would like to draw the pictures like this, you know, or photograph, memories, photographs, or whatever. Depends on them, depends on the children, their favorite ways, you know. But the reflection and keep the reflections as a record is really important. They can look back. This is important. And like this, the image is a spiral model. It's really important. So little by little, spiral, task setting, research, organize, and reflect, and summarize like this reflection, then little by little going up. Okay. Then for this spiral model, what's a teacher's job is facilitating and feedback. And today I'd like to set two quizzes. Now I'm seeing the YouTube chat box, so please kindly answer. Okay, so how do we evaluate them? Okay. Okay, the question is like this. A, which is better, feedback? Please answer in the chat box of YouTube. I'm watching now. Okay. A, the teacher often provides a positive feedback. Okay. Then B, the teacher often provides a negative feedback. Which is better teachers? Which is provide a good environment? B. Thank you. Yeah, lots of members answer. Yes, thank you very much. I expected you answer A. Oh, but some members are B. Very interesting. Thank you very much. Yes, over 90%, 95% teachers answer A, in fact. The positive feedback is really important. But there is no empirical result, empirical research. Positive feedback is better than negative feedback. In fact, it's up to teachers. Okay. If you are good at providing negative feedback, yeah, you can use it. If you are good at providing positive feedback, well, you can use it. But that combination is important. The balance is important. Okay. But now lots of teachers believe, oh, we need to provide a positive feedback. Then sometimes to spoil the children, it's not good. Sometimes we'll use a negative feedback. This combination is important. Okay. This is a first quiz. Second quiz, which is better? The teacher often focuses on the results. Oh, student did something, the student got something, the result. Then B, the teacher often focuses on the process. Okay, please answer in the chat box. Okay, good, lots of people answer B, B, A, A, B. Okay, thank you very much. Great. This is absolutely the correct answer is a B. This is a B. We shouldn't focus on the result. Okay, if we focus on the result, then we provide the feedback on the result. Students also only result. Then they are really afraid of making mistakes. But as you know, mistakes or fault is very good opportunities to host their non-cognitive skills. That's a failing or mistakes are welcomed, in fact. Okay. Then teachers need to focus on the process. Even they fail, it's okay. Making effort or try to, their trial is important, okay? Then it's called a flexible mindset. we need to host a flexible mindset. Okay. This flexibility is really important. This is absolutely the answer is a B. Okay. Okay, thank you very much for joining us. But even now, some people answer it, but okay, thank you very much. Yeah, that's our my presentations. There are some appendix that now Dr. Hisham mentioned about talk at some questions are like here. Okay, Namura Sensei, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Kawaguchi Sensei. I think your presentation was interactive using the function of the YouTube streaming. It was really good. And I think Dr. Hisham's presentation and your presentation was in a good series. I think Dr. Hisham pointed out the importance and introduction of the non-cognitive skill as a project under MACMU. And Professor Kawaguchi pointed out the how to foster, how to encourage people to incorporate those type, then how to evaluate. I think now the people participating in this podium are really clear about the concept and the how to popularize those non-cognitive skill education. And in your presentation, five skills and the positive meaningful feedback, but the positive negative should be mixed. Then the teacher should give a feedback for focusing on the process is very important. I think it was really clear to me. Thank you very much, Professor Kawaguchi, for the very informative presentation. Thank you. So next, I'd like to go for the Q&A session. From the secretariat, I heard that there are more than 145 questions through the YouTube comment. And also we have a few many questions through the Q&A form during the registration. So but the question which was selected from the secretariat was from the Q&A form, which could be very useful and common to all the speakers. Could you show the question? Okay, so I'd like to throw this question to the speakers for this session. What is the best method or instrument in measuring the attainment of lifelong learning and holistic education of the learners? Okay, I think that some presentation has already pointed out that, but could you share your thought about this? Maybe each person, maybe 1 minute, 1 to 2 minutes. So I'd like to start from the Dr. Ko from the Simio Cell, Vietnam. Floor is yours.
Thank you very much for allowing me to share my thinking about this question. What is the best method or instrument in measuring the attainment of lifelong learning and holistic education of the learners? Then to measure the attainment, normally we will immediately think about some kind of assessment, test, for example, quizzes, for example. But I believe that today we should think of the competency. Usually the test in the classroom can only measure the knowledge that the student or the learners have learned, but that knowledge only is not enough. I would like to think of the OECD definition of competency. It includes knowledge, skills, and attitudes. And I would like to give an example. In Vietnam, there was a time when university graduate got jobs in foreign companies, working for foreign companies. And the foreign company complained that what they learned, the knowledge that they learned, were not enough. And those new recruits had to be retrained, even if they were trained in university. So what the company were expecting is the real competency of the worker, it's not just the knowledge. So whatever as kind of assessment that we use, it should focus on competency.
Thank you very much. Yeah, understood. That I think the assessment of the competence is definitely very important for the I think global citizenship and the new, I think, working environment. You see, many people are exploring for developing the new method to measure their competencies. I think those traditional tests or quizzes cannot measure it, actually. Thank you very much. Okay, so next, I'd like to invite Dr. Hisham for your thought about this question.
All right, thank you, Dr. Nomura. Basically, I think there's no one size fits all to answer these questions. If you talk about best method, I think there's a lot of methods that we can choose from based on the context of who and what kind of group that we are trying to measure in terms of implementing holistic education. But I would like to refer to our project Markmore, that the kind of method and approach that we use to sort of look at the development of the characters of the learners will be through what Prof. Kawaguchi mentioned about reflection. So reflection is one of the ways or methods and approach that we use to look at the changes or the development of the learners when we implement the principles of Markmore. And what we observed is at three things. Number one, the mind of the learners, where the cognitive skills are actually changing or not, or developed or not. And then number two, whether the changes also affect their behavior. And number three, whether the whole community, the collective community, have changed the culture of the community towards what values or values that we want to impart. So this kind of measurement, I wouldn't use the word measurement, but reflection to see how we developed, whether positively or negatively, and how we can improve better with what we are working on.
So yeah, thank you very much for your input. Your answer was really clear to me. So the reflection in the three categories would be very effective to assess the attainment or achievement of the student. One is the like mindset or mind of the student. The second is the behavior. They're going for positive or negative, check their behavior, and maybe group behavior or the community change. I think that if we do this kind of reflection, in your point, that good assessment for checking the attainment of the student. Thank you very much. Okay, then next I'd like to invite Kawaguchi-sensei, Dr. Kawaguchi, for your input about this.
Thank you very much, Nomura-sensei. I completely agree with Dr. Hisham's opinion. Yes, so I don't need to say anything. Yeah, the oppository, it's very risky if we set the one best method. If we offer the method is like this, you know, it's not good, you know. The important point is who made the criteria or evaluations. You know, through discussion with children or you know consensus from parents by everyone, we need to set some evaluations or some method. You know. Otherwise, if we decide, okay, or teacher decide, oh, this is the best, I think it's not good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes. I think your presentation could be answer for this question, but you added one point that the keep improving by the input, incorporating the opinion from or the thought from many peoples and in the different standing point. So that's really important. We have one word called the Kaizen, improving. I think it's really important for this kind of the method development. Okay, thank you. Again, I'd like to extend my appreciation for the three speakers, four speakers for this session. And I hope that I think the many participants learned a lot of things from your presentation. Thank you very much. And also, I'd like to extend my expression to the more than 2,000 participants through the YouTube live. Okay, I'd like to close this session too. Thank you very much and good evening from Japan. Bye-bye. Thank you. I'd like to return the floor to the MC.
Thank you very much, Professor Nomura, for moderating this session. And thank you very much to all the speakers and moderators, and especially to all participants for your active participation. We have received so many questions and reflections from the Q&A form. and also for joining us in the symposium today. So for tomorrow's program, we would like to invite you to participate in the symposium, which will start at 9 a.m. Bangkok time. So tomorrow we also have two sessions. The first one is technology and values-driven transformation in K-12 education. And another session is session 4, which is technology and values-driven transformation in STEM and innovative vocational education. And for the last day of the symposium, we also have two very interesting topics to be discussed. The first one is technology and values-driven transformation in teacher and higher education. And the last session is innovative practices in technology and values-driven transformation in education, learning from actions. So last but not least, allow me to announce how to receive the e-certificate of participation for the first day of the symposium. So as you can see on the screen, we have provided here the QR code. So you can take the picture or scan the QR code, and do not forget to fill up the evaluation form to receive the e-certificate. But please do not forget that the deadline is on 21st of February at 6 p.m. Bangkok time. And we also, the link, as you can see, for the e-certificate is already pinned at the top of the chat box as well. All right, so now the first day of the symposium has come to an end. We hope to see you all again tomorrow for the second day of the symposium, starting at 9 a.m. Bangkok time. Have a nice afternoon ahead, and goodbye, and see you all tomorrow. Thank you very much.
It's time to open our eyes to a bright and promising future. We'll rise to the call of the times and create a stronger tomorrow. Let's start to make a difference, teaching everyone to learn through science, health and technology. We will share our expertise. By promoting knowledge and policies, we can build a better world.
Let us take a stand for a vicious world, making future plans for the people to grow in a life filled with happiness and dreams.
Goals through partnership, creating opportunities.